So we can finish getting your coffee and get moving. So Hector Garcia-Molina is here from Stanford. Hector is literally a giant in the database field. He's been doing databases for about 40 years, and distributed systems and search, transactions, a number of topics. He's done a lot of stuff in his career. He's a National Academies member. He's a fellow of a number of societies. He actually spent several years on the President's Information Technology Advisory Council, and I'm sure he wishes that he could do that right now, but we won't go there. So we're just really happy to have him here. For those of you who are thinking about going into academia, I have to say Hector is like who you should want to grow up to be like someday. He's published a tremendous number of papers and just done lots for our field, so we're happy to have you here.
Thank you. So please don't say how many years I've been in the field. It's only 20 years.
So Hector entered the field when he was 5.
That's it. Thank you for that warm and very nice introduction.
The microphone.
Yes. I was told to turn it on, but I forgot. See, that happens with my
age.
Okay.
Well, I had 45.
That's right. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. So it's an honor and a pleasure to be here talking to you. I'd like to get a lot of questions. This is about crowdsourcing, having people do things, so please crowdsource my talk, and then I have less work to do to ask questions or fix the mistakes I made during my talk. Let me tell you about crowdsourcing in general first, and then I'll say a little bit about the stuff that I've been involved in. So you've all heard, especially today, all these arguments about are machines going to be better than men, right? Or and women? Are they going to be smarter? Are they going to beat us? If you're a movie fan, you know what happens in the Terminator series. I was just reading a couple of days ago on the Economist. They had this editorial speculating that humans were going to go the way of the horse. Because the horses had a lot of jobs, right, a century ago. But very quickly, in the course of a decade or two, they were all out of a job. And now they do is like race and are pets somewhere. And maybe that's happened, going to happen to humans, right? But I personally think it's not going to happen soon. As a matter of fact, anybody who's watched these movies knows that humans can beat the computers, even in the future, right? We can do some things better than computers. So maybe some youngsters here should worry about what will happen when computers overtake us, but I, in my lifetime, will not see that, I'm fairly sure. So the whole point of crowdsourcing then is use this natural intelligence in a good way. If we have problems that humans can address, can solve better than a computer, let's ask them to solve the problem, or let's ask them to work together with the computer to solve a problem. So that's a general idea of crowdsourcing. Okay. So a few examples here. This is one of the earliest examples of crowdsourcing. The sheriff in the Old West needed to do a task, which is capture the bad guy. He can't do it by himself, and he asks the crowd to help find the bad guy, right? It's a case where the coordinator of the task is a human and the workers are human, right? We're gonna be looking at computer-human interaction in a second. That's one example. Here's another example of purely human crowdsourcing. This, they were computing some sort of log tables or some math table, so you had somebody directing the workers to perform the task and then they would collect the results. So that's another case where this is a case of a private crowd where you're using a specific set of trained workers to work, but you can have that. I mean, the first case was a public crowd, anybody could do it, but here you have specific workers. Here's a more recent example. Hey, if you go to Google and you look for people, if it's a person who has a presence in the web, for example, John Hennessy, who's a well-known computer scientist at Stanford, and he was also the president of our university until very recently, you get these very nice little boxes there. I'm sure if you look for Mike Carey, you also would get your own little box. And it has a combination of things, a little bio from Wikipedia, some other information from some other source, some photos, co-authors, movie stars that they work with, or whatever. Now, where does this come from? Well, it doesn't come from one single source. It comes from different sources that I just indicated. And it's hard to figure out which are the John Hennessy's. For example, here, I think this made a mistake. I mean, that doesn't look like a John Hennessy in that photo. And computers are good at figuring out if it's the same person, but not as good as humans. So the way Google does these boxes and Facebook cleanses information on restaurants and other things is by doing some machine algorithm, but also asking people to work on the harder problems in some intelligent way. That's what I'm going to talk about, how can we get people to help out in tasks like this. So this is an example of actually a crowd-powered result where humans are involved in getting it. Here's another one that maybe you have heard of, or your professors here will hope that you haven't heard of it. There are these sites that do editing and writing for students or people who need it, right? So you send them a job, I want to proofread, I actually use it with my students. They write a paper, their first paper, say, well, let's first send it to wording. They subcontract it to an editor in the crowd. Again, it's not the public crowd, they have to be some good editors, and then they give you the comments, and the student fixes the problems, and then I get to read the paper after it's been fixed. Of course, some students skip the having to write the paper and just ask for the paper to be written for them, but let's not get into that. That's another example of crowdsourcing. You're asking people outside for help. Another very different example is crowdfunding, where you ask people not for editing or for information, but you ask them for money to fund a new product, a new movie, for example. How many people have watched this movie? It's one of my favorite movies. Very few here. It's a hilarious movie, and it was crowdfunded. The funding they got was by asking a whole bunch of people to give them some money. The premise, by the way, in case it's here, that in 1945, when the Nazis were defeated, they actually weren't defeated. They actually retreated to the dark side of the moon, and they've been living there and building up this big base to attack Earth in the future. It's a very funny movie, so you should watch it. We have some people standing there. There's a few chairs over here if you want to sit down, there's like four over here, or if you want to stand, that's fine. But why don't you come up here? Or actually, you could, I guess, grab some of these in front and put them on the side, just so you're comfortable. Up here. I won't bite. Okay, so I'll continue then. So there's lots of other examples I could give you. The crowd, for example, has been used in disasters to match lost kids with people that are looking for their kids after an earthquake, for example. Shopping sites use crowdsourcing to categorize systems to find out what are good deals on products and so on, to check the relevance. All the search engines are constantly running the results through a crowd to see how accurate, how useful the results that they're producing, and they fine-tune that based on things. If you are a machine learning person, often you get your training data by going to the crowd and asking them to classify your photos or analyze the data, and then you can write an algorithm and try to do close to what the humans can do. Okay, two last examples just for fun. The first one is a true example. It's a classic, maybe some of you have heard of it. The second one, you'll have to decide if it's true or not. They're all crowdsourcing. So I love this story of how the crowd worked. And you'll see how we get porno sites in here in a second. So years ago, I think it was Yahoo email was having problems with spammers opening accounts. They wanted to have an account where they could send spam emails out, and they needed a lot of these accounts because after they sent spam mail, then they would be detected and the account would be closed down, so they constantly need to be creating accounts. So Yahoo and other email providers provided safeguards to make sure that robots could not open accounts. So you've seen the CAPTCHAs and other questions that they ask you to make sure that it's a human that's opening an account. But what the spam email providers did is they came up with a strategy. They have a program, the coordinator, that sends an open account request to, let's say, Yahoo, for example. And it's a robot, they go through the process and they get this CAPTCHA that the computer can't solve. They have to translate some image into numbers. So what they do is they partnered with a porno site, and which is the crowd in this case. So they sent to the porno site the CAPTCHA, and somebody at the porno site gets this message saying, oh, if you solve this, we'll show you three dirty pictures. and people would type in the answer, which would go back to the coordinator and back to opening the account, and you had a happy customer at the porno site. Isn't that ingenious, right? A human power at work. Okay, so that's a true story, I'm told. And this is the second story, which you have to decide if it's true or not, of crowdsourcing. Remember The Matrix, I guess you've seen the movie The Matrix? Do you know the story behind what was happening is that humans were being sort of farmed for energy in that case, right? They all were living in these pods. They were imagining all this virtual world, but they were really being crowdsourced, right? And the Matrix was getting energy out of them. So it's another crowdsourcing example, I claim, right? You're supposed to laugh. But it is crowdsourcing. So again, continuing in the sort of the overview mode, let me just tell you about the different varieties of crowdsourcing. You've seen some examples, but just to organize the space, two important parameters are whether the coordinator that's trying to solve the problem is a computer and a human. We saw some examples of a human and or a computer. And the workers, just for completeness, we're going to focus on human workers, of course, otherwise it wouldn't be crowdsourcing. But I put here in my diagram computers. And they're actually four different parts of the spectrum. Old-fashioned was human and human. This was, for example, the sheriff and the log tables. They were all human. Space two, where it's a computer and a computer, that's what's distributed computing, or you might well call it cloud computing, or whatever the trendy term for distributed computing is today. It's just the computer has some work to do. It farms it out to sort an array, and a number of computers sort the pieces, and you put it back together. That's what happens. And area three is what I'm going to focus on. A computer is asking workers, human workers, to help them solve a problem. So that sort of puts in context crowdsourcing. Another axis here is what is the output of the crowdsourcing task. It can be data, like the log tables. It can be money, like crowdfunding. It can be documents, like in Wordy, or it can be like a training set, which is also a type of data, but that's going to be used by a machine learning algorithm for training, right? So that's another dimension that you're going to look at. In this talk, because I'm a database person, I'm going to focus on data as the output. So basically data, human workers, and a computer trying to coordinate the task at hand. Okay. A couple of other interesting dimensions that you should just be aware of. One is the granularity. Are the tasks that the human's doing small tasks, or are they big tasks? Wordy, for example, it's a bigger task. You're editing or writing a paper, so it's a bigger task. In micro crowdsourcing, the tasks are relatively small. Here's a picture, tell me what's in it. Which is better, A or B? Or what's the price, the best price on the web that you can get for this pair of shoes that I'm showing you here. So they're relatively small tasks. And as I'll say in a minute, there are sites that can help you with either type of crowdsourcing. The most famous of the micro crowdsourcing sites is Mechanical Turk, run by Amazon, where you can go and get workers to do small tasks. But there are then larger sites like, it's not called Elan, what was the original? See, that's what happens with age. Excuse me? No. Anyway, I think it's called Elan now, but it was well known as, anyway, I had students working there. anyway, where you hire like people to do programs for you. So you want to hire some programmers, and you can interview them and hire them through Odesk, excuse me, was the name, original name that I know about, but they, year ago, sort of changed their name. So there's a variety of options there. Another axis that is important to understand is the incentives. Why are the workers working for you on this task? They can just be paid money, like at Odesk and Mechanical Turk, small amounts of money or bigger amounts of money. Sometimes they do it for entertainment. For example, there's some famous systems built by, I'm showing my age, at CMU, like ESD game. Louis Vanon, yes. You sort of remember
it. Sort of.
Where people would be playing, they thought they were playing a game. It was like, for example, the most famous one is the ESP game, where you had people shown photographs and they're supposed to tag them, and they think they're playing a game against an opponent, trying to guess what the other opponent is going to tag things with. So they're involved in this game. What they're really doing is tagging the photos for you, getting that data for you. So that's a very ingenious use of crowdsourcing, but you don't pay the workers, they have fun doing things. Some do it for philanthropy just because it's a good task, like counting birds in Christmas, the Christmas bird count, where lots of people all over the world go out and count and watch birds and report the data. So they do it for that. And then there is hidden crowdsourcing, which is very common by, say, the search engines. You observe what the crowd is doing and learn from that the patterns, what pages are popular, what pages are not popular, and so on. It's the crowd that's giving you that data, but they don't really know they're working for you. They're doing their searches, and they're just shopping and doing searches and so on, and you're tracking of what they're doing. So these are all different types of incentives that you have. Again, I'm gonna focus here on money or specific payment and small tasks, okay? So, as I said, I'd like to get questions. I haven't gotten a single question, and I'm going to switch gears a little bit. This was sort of almost the end of the overview that I want to give. Any questions or comments, other axes that you think I should have on my diagram? Any question? Good.
At what point does, let's say, as technology advances, does a certain crowdsourcing task become better done by a computer than a human? And how do you like determine that?
I don't know. That's a challenge. Yeah, as I said, computer technology is advancing. Someday, some of you youngsters will have to face this question. But right now, it's fairly clear. I mean, the tasks that are usually crowdsourced are tasks that have to do with perception, image analysis, language, translating things, which humans are still better. And also, one is sort of human taste. If you're a fashion company trying to figure out what bags or purses go with what dresses, for example, a computer is going to have a hard time because it's not a logical decision, it's sort of a human taste. So you better ask people to match the handbags or the shoes with the dresses and the coats, and humans are good at that type of task, because what you want to learn is what humans like, not what computers like. Okay, good. Any other questions? Oh, yes, please, good. They're coming in now.
Yeah, so a lot of the examples that you gave are things that are not urgent, not necessarily mission critical. Mm-hmm. And there's been a lot of talk about using crowdsourcing in human-oriented data and more urgent applications and mission critical applications. And what I was just trying to get your take on that is that, what do you think is the feasibility of using something like that?
Well, that's an excellent question, yes. One of the drawbacks of crowdsourcing is that humans are somewhat slower. They might give you more accurate answers for some tasks, but they're a little slower. If you need the data quickly, like in the search box, the John Hennessy example, well, you do that in advance, right? When you search for John Hennessy, Google doesn't go and ask people at that point. You've done it in advance. But the disadvantage is that you can only do it for some limited number of people. They won't show you a box for every single search you perform. And I think that's because of the need to cache the answers there. The latency is one of the challenges. As a matter of fact, one of the examples, more detailed examples I'm going to talk about is how can you reduce the latency of answers? It's still not going to make it real time, but at least try to reduce the time it takes to answer questions. So I don't have a better answer than that. Yes?
Is there a dimension in your classification that has to do with privacy? For example, users may not want to be identified when they give the data, or at the other extreme, they may want to get full credit and get some points.
Yeah, so the question is, do we need an access for privacy? And that's a very good point. I should have, that could be another access. I just hadn't considered that for this overview. Yes, because sometimes the workers are being paid to work on the task, but other times they are people that go and work in Mechanical Turk, or especially for the hidden type of incentive. That's them, there it's more critical because they don't know, or the entertainment ones, they think they're doing one thing, but they're really being mined for the knowledge. That's absolutely a good point. Okay.
I just want to add one more example. Recapture.
Yes.
It's also a crowdsourcing solution for OCR.
That's right, yes.
Recapture is used to do OCR detection.
That's right. So in case you're not familiar with that, then the capture that you get is some piece of OCR text that somebody needs to have OCR converted to text. So they're using, that is a case of hidden, right?
Hidden.
Yeah, so you're doing work, but you don't know you're doing it. It's a great example. Yes, last one, and then I'll move on, and then we have more time for questions at the end.
I feel another possible dimension might be the quality of the outcome. For example, like if they need to be really high quality, they might have to contract him. If they need to worry about the legal liability, they probably have to, you know, making sure they pay someone, making sure they don't.
Absolutely, the quality. As a matter of fact, later on in the talk, I have three other axes, which are sort of for a lot of problems. You want to look at the quality, the cost, and the latency. Those are the three key design parameters when you're building a solution that you have to worry about. Yeah, so I'll come back to those axes. Great. Great. I'm glad I got all these questions. So let me move on, and then, but you can still interrupt me if I'm getting bored. Okay, so the title of the talk is Crowdsourcing for Real. I mean, why is this important? So I'm going to do this in two parts. One, is it used in practice? Who's using it? I already hinted that there are companies doing this. So I think that's an easy sell. And the other one for a research community, like, as well, are interesting problems to work on. I know some of you here are already working on crowdsourcing things, but I'm trying to get more people excited in this area. So I'm going to try to answer that question by showing you what I think are some exciting things that we've been doing in our group. So is crowdsourcing used? Yes, there's a lot of companies that are providing crowdsourcing services. They range from platforms like Mechanical Turk and Crowdflower, where you go and submit tasks and they find workers for you. There are consulting firms where you go with a crowdsourcing problem and then people there help you design a crowdsourced solution. There's crowdfunding. There's all sorts of design places where you go and can design your company logo using the crowd, all sorts of interesting solutions. So it's a growing and very active space. On the research side, there are a lot of universities. I don't think I have. Right here. This is just a sampling from a few years ago. I don't have you guys here. I should have added you instead of Cal. But anyway, there's a lot of everybody. There's a lot of people doing work in this area. So that was my convincing you that is an important area worth paying attention to. But now let's get down to business. And I'm going to give you three examples, and that's going to be the talk, right, the rest of the talk. The first one is a little bit more detailed, and then the other two are going to be sort of just define the problem, and I won't give you too many details. But if we run out of time and only do the first one or two, that's fine. I mean, it's, we'll see how it goes. Okay? Ready to go? So data processing. So here is, I picked, there's a lot of problems you could do, and they have a similar flavor, so I just picked one of the ones that we've worked on because it's a very easy to understand problem. So here's the problem. You have a job description, you're trying to hire somebody, and you have a bunch of CVs that people have submitted. So you have hundreds of them. But it could be the same thing. It could be a pair of shoes and dresses. You're trying to find the best match, which is the best dress for that pair of shoes, which is the best CV for that job description. A lot of things where you're trying to find what is good for. Now, you could give one worker in the crowd all the CVs and ask her to find the best match. But that's too much work for one person because you might have hundreds of CVs. So we want to split up the problem into pieces that are more manageable by a worker. And in splitting the problem up, you have to worry about three parameters. Here's the three axes that I haven't shown. The cost, how many times do I have to go and ask a worker to do something? The uncertainty, what is the quality of the result? Workers can make mistakes. So sometimes I have to ask the question to multiple workers so I can average out or find the common answer. And how long does it take? An important factor with crowdsourcing. Okay. So Let for this particular part of the talk, I'm going to focus on the latency and cost trade-off. But you could write a paper on cost uncertainty or any other of the combinations here. Well, there's lots of interesting problems out there waiting. So looking at the, what did I say, latency and cost, here's two very simple ways to solve the problem that have dramatically different latencies and costs. So here we have five CVs on the left column. I said we're going to have hundreds, but let's just for this example say we have five. And I'm going to propose a fully serial strategy for asking the crowd. So I'm going to take one pair of CVs and ask somebody in the crowd which is the better fit for this job description, A or B. So I have to wait because submitting a job takes time. I have to post it on Mechanical Turk. The workers have to go around, look for jobs. They find the job. They say you're going to do it. They do it. You get the results. So it can take seconds, minutes for the answer to come back. Then say A was deemed to be the first one. Now, since I'm not worried about accuracy in this part of the talk, let's assume that the workers don't make mistakes. If you are worried about users making mistakes, then for each of these red lines, you have to ask, say, five workers, which is better, A or B, and then you take the majority. Say if three, four, or five say A is better, then you assume that A is the right answer, and then you continue. Okay, so that's one simple way in which you can deal with the uncertainty, but there are more efficient ways of doing it, but I won't cover them here today. So A wins, then you pick another pair, A and C. Let's say C wins, then serially, then you compare C and D, and C wins, and then you compare C and E, and you have the final answer, the best CV for that particular job that you had in mind. So this is a slow process. It's going to take the number of steps equal to the number of items, minus one, of course. But it's very efficient in the number of questions you ask. You're not wasting any work because each of the questions you ask lets you get rid of one CV, so you're making progress. Contrast this with the fully parallel algorithm, which says, I'm going to ask all at once, I'm going to send a batch of questions, and this is feasible on these crowdsourcing platforms. I can just package my task and say, here are all these pairs, and ask people the crowdsourcing space. There's lots of workers, so it'll go out, and some workers will start working on them, and they will start getting responses. It'll take some time. A little bit more than a single question because that they're done in parallel, so it's not a lot more because a lot of the cost is setting up the assignment on Mechanical Turk. So in one step, which might take longer than the steps in the other diagram, you get the final answer. But notice that now we're asking a whole bunch of questions, more than the five questions or four questions we asked in the previous one. Okay, so that's basically the trade-off. I can be faster if I'm wasteful with my questions and do them in parallel. So one way to think of it is plot the cost in terms of the number of tasks that have to be solved and the time it takes. The fully serial is the least expensive, but it takes the longest. Fully parallel is over here. And what I want is something in between that is reasonable cost and is reasonably fast. Okay, so in other words, one way to phrase this problem is to say, okay, suppose I have a budget of how many questions. Remember, each question is going to cost me 10 cents, 20 cents. This is the most I want to spend on solving this problem, and I want to find the smallest time, the best time to solve the problem. So this is a minimum latency formulation of the problem that we have. Okay, any questions? I need a drink, so you can think about a question. Yes?
On the two different approaches, it seems like if you go serially, you can kind of pretend that there's a total order and like a maximum. If you go in parallel, it seems like you could have inconsistent, you know, what happens if you're getting something where there isn't a total order, essentially? How do you combine those results?
That's right. That's a good question. This is not the question for this model, Okay. Because you were assuming that the workers are correct. And if the works are correct, there can be no inconsistencies. But it's a very interesting problem. We also have written a paper on that version of the problem. That deals with more of the accuracy side, because in that model, workers can make mistakes.
Right.
You might say that A is better than B, but Chen might say that B is better than A.
Right.
So then I have to ask additional questions. And the problem there becomes, well, which are the questions that I should ask to sort of resolve the pending disagreements that I have. Another fascinating, the Max problem, that's why I like the Max problem. It's a lot of, it's simple enough that it has a lot of rich variations that you can work with. Yes, please.
Yeah, just to follow on to that, it may not be an accuracy issue. It's, if you're asking for human judgment, if you look at the work of Danny Kahneman and Amos Tversky, they'll say that you know you won't have a sort of strict ordering or a property.
Absolutely right, yes, yes.
So if you go to the psychological measure.
That's right, that's right. Or it could even be a voting type of thing, right, where there is no notion and you just want to see how many people like somebody, which is the most popular person here in this room, for example. Yes, so yeah, a lot of interesting variations. For this particular problem, let's assume that there is a sort of ground truth ordering, and when you ask somebody, they'll give you the right answer, just so we can focus on the cost latency trade-off. Good, thanks for the questions and clarifications. Okay, so let me briefly describe the framework and then our solution, and then argue that the solution that we have, this by the way appeared in the Sigma paper recently. So we have, our input is the budget that we have, the number of questions, maximum number of questions we're going to ask, the number of elements, CV, addresses, whatever we're evaluating. We're going to assume a latency function that tells us how long it takes to answer Q questions. Now, of course, people will complain, well, how do we know this latency function, and how do we know it's going to be exact? And we're only going to use the latency function to help us in our design of the algorithm, but it's not going to affect the correctness of the algorithm, because it's only going to be an estimate to let us know which one is better, how serial should we be, how parallel should we be. So it's going to be innate. If the function is wrong, the worst that could happen is that we won't pick a good algorithm latency-wise, but it'll still give us the right answer. Okay? As I said, we're going to assume reliable workers, just to keep things manageable today. We're going to proceed in rounds. Each round will take this amount of time. And I'm going to divide the problem into two parts. Now, you don't have to proceed in rounds, but again, it makes the problem manageable to keep to do it. Otherwise, it gets really hard and we couldn't solve it. But that's something that somebody might want to look at, not fixed rounds. But so first part is select a budget. If you have 100 questions to ask, you first have to decide how many questions am I going to ask per round, right? Or at least the first round. You have to say, if I have 100, I want to ask 20 questions the first round. So you don't have to compute the whole budget vector at once. You can do it incrementally. But for simplicity here, I'm just going to assume that you compute the whole budget vector. And then once you have the budget vector, in each round, you have to decide, OK, I have 10 questions for the first round. How am I going to allocate those questions? Which of the possible pairs that I'm going to compare should I ask this time? Because you have a lot of pairs, and you have to pick which ones. Okay. So these are the two things I'm going to talk about. How do we select the budget? And then once we have the budget, how do we select the questions? And they're closely related. So here's a little example to show you what I have in mind. Let's say we have 30 elements. Here's one budget vector on the left. There are two examples on the slide. Round one, we allocate our 15 questions as shown here. Note, for example, that A and C are not being compared here. And then in round two, after round one, we're going to be left with some number of items that have to be that are still possibly the best one, and then we compare them. Again, here we're missing; we're not comparing everything against everything, and then we are left with two, and we then have the final answer. Okay. The other one is again a different one. We have a different vector, but this is the choices we made. So it's illustrating the vector and how we decided on the questions. Now, the interesting thing was the one on the right has a very special pattern, and that is that the question selection, once we're given the budget, is proceeding in tournament rounds. In other words, what the strategy on the right is we divide the elements that we have, the 12 elements, into groups. We partition the groups, and then within each group, we ask all the questions. In this case, the groups are two, so all the questions is just one. In this case, the groups are two, and we ask three questions among themselves. What's really neat about that particular strategy is that the number of survivors equals the number of groups. Here we had six groups. for each group, because you're asking all the questions, you're definitely going to have a winner, and that's going to move on to the next round. That's why you have six here. Since you have two groups, then each group is going to have a winner, and now you have a round. So it's like sports tournaments that you have. And that is really a nice property for analyzing these algorithms, that you know how things proceed. Furthermore, you know in this round, for example, that these two are equally likely to be the maximum, because each one has won the same number of comparisons than the other. So for analyzing this, I'm not going to go into detail, it helps to know that everything's on an even field. Here, it's not the same. This one might have more, is more likely to win another because of the comparisons are irregular. So this one might have won more comparisons than this one in that previous graph, because we're not comparing everything against everything. For example, if this is the winner that goes here, then you didn't compare it against this guy. Anyway, so it just doesn't have that property. Okay, so we're going to use that property to then try to figure out four tournament graphs. Let's at least try to solve the budget allocation problem on tournament graphs. So now I'm restricting the solutions to, we're only going to use tournament graphs, but I'll convince you in a few minutes that this was a good decision, a good simplification to make. So here are two solutions that use tournament graphs. So they both satisfy our constraint, and now which one is the best one? We have to decide that. Okay. So it turns out that this particular problem is doable quite efficiently. Now, just as a clarification, the goal is not to minimize the number of questions, but to minimize the latency. We want to get the fast one, as long as we're within the budget, right? So we can't go over our budget, but we have to minimize the latency. So how do we do it? Well, our algorithm, developed by Vasilis, one of my students, finds the optimal one, the optimal budget vector using dynamic programming. So it searches the space of possible vectors and finds the optimal one. So I have a couple of slides that will just give you the flavor of how this works. It's not that hard. So just this is classical dynamic programming. Suppose you want to fill up this table that shows you the optimal latency for a particular B and C from of a given size. So if I have a budget of 5 and I have 6 elements, this table is going to give me the right answer. Now, we're going to fill out the whole table, which you might think is a waste of time, but it turns out to be a time saver, because you can work backwards. To fill in this number, I'm going to fill it from this direction, so I'll have the other numbers available, so it'll make it a lot easier to reuse the stuff that I've done in the past, the computations that I've done in the past. So how do I find out the optimal latency there? Well, I have, six objects, and I said, well, how am I going to do them? What am I going to do the first round? I have to decide on the first round. Suppose that I say, well, I'm going to divide the 6 into 3 groups of 2 each. Okay, this is an if. Suppose I want to reduce it the first round from 6 to 3. That's how I'm going to start the process. Well, that means that if I do this, then the time to solve this problem is going to be the time. So if I'm going to be left with 3 items, and my budget is going to be reduced because the cost of doing this strategy is 3 questions, right? So it's going to cost me 3 questions, and I'm going to reduce the number of elements from 6 to 3. So I'm going to go to here, read it off my table, read this x, and the cost, it's not the optimal, but the cost, if I use this step first, will be the latency for asking 3 questions, whatever that function gives me, plus whatever x gives me. Okay, so I'm just using my data before to find out what would be the latency if I have 6 objects, a budget of 5, and the first step is the one that's indicated here, reducing the elements from 6 to 3. Now, that's not the optimal y, that's one y. What I have to do is consider what are all the possible first steps that I have to take. So I'm going to consider the different steps that reduce it from 6 to 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, reading off the appropriate values here, and then I pick the best one. 3 might not have been the best one, so I will pick whichever one is the best one, and that's the one I'm going to plug into my table, and then I'll move on to the next value and the next value, and we'll fill in my table until I get to the one that I'm really interested in. Okay? Any questions on this? It's a classic dynamic programming strategy, and it works well. So, the key thing here is that you can this proves that the algorithm, this dynamic programming algorithm, TDP as we call it, has better worst case latency than any budget allocation scheme, regardless of the question selection algorithm. It's easy to see because of the construction that will do the best if we have tournament allocations. But actually, you can show that for any allocation, even one that's not a tournament, you still will beat it. So it's not only works for tournaments, but anything, it'll still be the best worst case performance. And on the average case, it also works fairly well as we show experimentally. This we can prove this is experimental. Why does it beat the others? Well, just again, the intuition is this. Suppose that you give me the one on the left, that which is not a tournament, and you tell me, well, this one is better than what you can do with tournaments. Remember, this one doesn't compare everything against everything. Well, if you claim that that one is the best one, I can construct something that is based on tournaments on the right and gives me better or at least the same performance. And that's because in here, because they're not tournaments, I can see that in this example that A and C could both be winners here, because if they happen to be the highest two values, then I won't be able to resolve A and C, so they will have to move on to the next phase. So the possible remaining elements are those six in that strategy, because it's not tournaments. And if you're going to give me six elements the next round, might as well ask the six groups with tournaments, and I'll ask fewer questions than you are asking and get the same result, which is six elements in the next phase. Okay, so no matter what scheme you give me, I can always reduce it to one that, in the worst case, takes the same the fewer questions than your scheme does and gives me the same answer. Okay, so that sort of shows that this algorithm is the best for all types of question assignments. Okay, I'm running a little low on time, so I'm not going to go into experimental results, but trust me, we've done a lot of experiments, both live experiments on Mechanical Turk and simulations, and compared our budget allocation with a whole bunch of others, and it clearly gives you better results in the sense that you can reach the optimum in less time than with the other allocation strategies. Okay, so let me stop here and take questions, and then I'll have time for one of the other two subjects.
Just a quick comment. The tournament graph approach is actually very reminiscent of work that was done in P2P dissemination, where the idea was you have a big file, you split it up into chunks, and then you pairwise exchange, you know, the chunks, and then what's the minimum number of steps you need for everybody to get all the chunks.
That's right.
And
that's
it's
right.
Very similar in this. And there were some assumptions that were made in those cases, which is, you know, network latency between every two of them is the same or something of that kind.
That's right, yeah.
And I suspect that there are similar kinds of assumptions.
And there's a lot of other work in the theory community just right. Doing maximum sorting. The key difference here, I think, between prior work is that we're focusing on the latency, and we have this function that describes the real latency in the crowdsourcing environment. Because most cases, if you assume a fixed time to do things, right? Or you in a multiprocessor environment, you have a fixed number of machines. So each round, you can do so many steps, and they take the same amount of time. Because they're computers, you can predict how long you're going to take at each step. But here, the timing is not predictable in the same way. Yeah. So there's a lot of similarity, but there are some key differences, we think. Yes, we can talk some more afterwards. Yes?
Hector, I think one of the assumptions sort of you made here was that an individual task for crowdsourcing is a comparison. But in reality, I could potentially give not one, but multiple other cluster of them, right?
Yes.
Does the approach change, or can you, does this approach generalize to that problem as well?
Well, it doesn't generalize directly, but that's an excellent question. I should have mentioned here, what I'm using here for this particular talk and paper is a pairwise approach. I'm doing two at a time, but as Shard mentioned, you could do four at a time. And that gets more interesting when you consider accuracy, because as you ask the worker to do more, we've done experiments, the accuracy starts to go down, right? So there's a trade-off there as to how much work can I get from a worker by giving him four, because if I give you four, I'm basically getting, six comparisons. If I give you four, so I'm getting more bang for my buck. If I only pay you $1 and you're getting me six, that's better. But first, you might take a little bit longer, and you're not as accurate because you're being overwhelmed by too many comparisons. So it's a fascinating topic, and I could point you to some papers that deal with that particular problem. How do you use a different interface, more work? Yeah. Good. Okay. So I have about 3 minutes. So I'm not going to cover the other two topics. Let me just switch gears because to give you a very different type of scenario where you're still dealing with data and the crowd. Okay. So there's a lot of problems that some of us have addressed in the same vein, right? You have a particular problem you have to solve, and you then look at the latency or the cost or the accuracy and so on. So it's a lot of work. But now let me talk about using the crowd just very briefly, just to give you the flavor for data gathering. Here, we're not doing a task on the data, but we want to gather the data. So here's the idea. This is one way to think of it. Since some of us here are database people, we'd like to think of the world this way. You have a database-like thing, you have declarative queries, say in SQL, you have your traditional databases, you have the web, and now you have the crowd. In other words, when I look at you here, all I see in your heads are little disks spinning, right? You all have bits of information in those little heads of you, or bigger heads, and I want to be able to query those. Like, you know what are good restaurants in Irvine, for example. Or which airport should I go to if I'm going to San Francisco, and so on. So you're an information source. So I'd like to view that as a database, not as I have to send you a task and ask you something, but I want to view it as a database and use declarative queries to get at that information. So the traditional view is that we're going to have a schema that defines what is in the database and what people can provide. And then we're going to have a conceptual view on that. And then people are going to be able to query that view. If you're not a database expert, don't worry. But here's a simple example. Suppose I'm interested in restaurants in the Palo Alto area. And this is what I want my users to be able to query. Restaurant, the rating, and the cuisine. Right? So now, that information is not stored in my database initially, but what I have is three sort of, three possible tables that can be filled in by the crowd, okay? So there is a set of restaurants, and I could ask people to give me restaurants. There are the ratings for restaurants, and there is the cuisine for the restaurant. So when you query, you're gonna do the top pink one, but this is what is gonna be underneath. And for each of these pseudo tables, I'm going to give you an access method. Just like in databases, I can tell you you can go through an index and get this. I'm going to tell you that a fetch rule says that if I give you the name of a restaurant, then there is a process for going out to the crowd and getting a rating for that restaurant. Okay? If I can give you a restaurant, there's also a way to go and get the cuisine for that restaurant. Or, in this case, there might also be a rule in the other direction. If I give you French cuisine, then there's a way to go and ask people, give me the names of French cuisine restaurants in your area. Okay, so those are, just like the fetch, the access methods in programs. There's also a resolution rule that says if the workers disagree on the ratings, then the resolution rule might say, get me the average. Or If they have duplicates, for example, then eliminate duplicates. Just give me one of them. I don't need to know that the cuisine is California cuisine for that restaurant. Okay. So basically, what is happening here, you're defining what looks to be like tables, but instead of having access methods to go to the disk, they have programs that go and ask people for the answers. The challenge here is how do you build a query processor, right? In databases, those who've taken your database class know that there's some work to be done when somebody says, find me five-star restaurants that have French cuisine. Then there's a little program called the query optimizer that goes and finds out, okay, how am I going to solve that need that you have by going and accessing and indexing and scanning a table? Here is going to be what queries do I have to issue to answer this question? So you want five-star restaurants that have a French cuisine. You might have cached some answer from the crowd before, but if you have if you don't have anything, then you have to say, well, do I maybe have already a list of restaurants? Let's assume you have a list of restaurants, but I don't know their rating or their cuisine. So I'm going to have to start issuing queries, maybe given the access method that I can go from cuisine to names of restaurants, I'll ask people, give me the name of French restaurants that you know. And I'll start populating my table with French restaurants. Then I need the rating. So I'm going to then have to start asking people, okay, now that I know the name of Bites, which is a little eatery next to our computer science department, then I'm going to have to go and ask people, what do you think of Bites? And collect that information. Okay, on the fly, dynamically, the query optimizer is going to have go out and decide in what order to get the data, how to combine it, how to aggregate it, and then present it to the user. Obviously, this is not something for the people that are in a hurry or in a rush, because it's going to take time. But we think that it's an interesting thing to think about. You're asking a set of maybe experts in the field to help you construct the answer that you need for some hard problem. You want to collect the data that you need for analysis. So you're dividing the task of filling up this table into subtasks in an efficient way. So that's the problem of sort of query optimizing when your devices are not traditional databases, but little disks spinning in people's heads, and I want to get the information from them. Any questions on this? Do you think it's a crazy idea? Or not completely crazy.
What information do you collect after accessing every table, virtual table?
Well, that's to be determined, right? You could just cache everything that you've learned from the crowd in the hope that some other query that you get in the future might need that information too. So you're going to have a collection of facts that you've retrieved in the past, and those might help you answer the question that comes in the query, but if that's not enough data, then you have to go and fetch additional information. So it's unlike a traditional database where you know this is the data and I just query what's there and that's it. But here, I can always get more restaurants, more ratings, so it's a little bit more open-ended. Obviously, in this world, the query also has to specify a budget or a time limit, right? Get me, answer this query, but with this time limit. You can't afford to just go indefinitely asking for more and more restaurants and more ratings. So it's a different way of thinking of database systems. Yes?
So it seems to me one of the main challenges here is going to be the reliability of people.
That's right.
For example, with these ratings, how can you make sure that the ratings are actually correct? Either there might be mistakes by human or malice.
That's right, absolutely.
Competitors coming in and trying to give you a bad rating. So how hard is it to actually get something reliable out of human?
Well, that's a different talk. It's a very important problem, obviously. There are different techniques. I mean, one of the, that they all sort of use worker evaluation or worker dismissal, although that might not be a politically correct a term. You have to figure out what's the quality of the answers that a worker is giving you. Now, sometimes you might be able to test them, right? So you might have some questions, and I'll ask you, what is this? And if you say water bottle, then you got the right answer because I know it's a water bottle, and then I can go and ask you other questions. But the problem with that type of test is that word spreads quickly, what are the test questions, and they're not as useful. Also, the workers tend to know that the first questions might be the test, so they'll do better at that. So another common technique that's used is comparing against other workers. If I ask five workers to tell me what this is, and four of them say water bottle, and you say it's a Coke, then it's not proof that you're wrong, because maybe the other four are wrong, but it's some evidence that you are in the minority and that you're giving an answer that's not consistent with the majority, right? So I collect that type of information, and based on your performance compared to others, I might decide that you are on the erroneous side and then not hire you. Or what's more common in these systems, because if you fire somebody and blacklist them, then they go and badmouth you in the forums. So what you have to do is just not give you jobs. I don't tell you you're fired, but I just give you fewer and fewer jobs, and then you get tired of waiting and then you go away. So that's another technique. So there are all sorts of issues. Yes?
So unlike in the previous case, typically when you think of crowdsourcing, we think of simple questions.
Mm-hmm.
And we think of people who, like, things that people can answer quite easily.
Mm-hmm.
Here, I think you're looking for experts. And that's a slightly, in fact, significantly different problem. How do I know who can answer this question?
That's right.
If I look for a French restaurant, I know maybe I can go to Mike. He eats French. He likes French food. But how do I know that? No, don't go to somebody else. So
yes.
I think that problem has to be, it's hidden somewhere.
It's hidden somewhere, and I hit it well, but not well enough. Because you found it. Yes, that's another issue, and we were talking about that earlier with one of you on the qualification. Not only is there, you want to evaluate the workers as are they giving me the right answers, but also classify them as to what they're good at, right? So that's a whole different spectrum. I can keep track on what is their expertise, where do they make mistakes, or when I hire them, if I have something like no desk, I hire them, I can give them some, they can give me their background. All sorts of interesting questions. Or, like some companies do, they just hire, the vetting is done in person, right? So I'm a company, I need workers to be doing this, so I hire the workers that I know are experts in this area, and then I put them in the room, and then they get the work done. Incidentally, there are some companies that outsource this. There's companies in, like, the Philippines, where they have a set of workers that they have vetted, and then you're sending the jobs not just to anybody, but one of the workers in this company. So another interesting problem. The last topic, I'll just say one word, is I think another variation. Here we sort of try to build a database-like thing with people. The last project was building a search engine with that relies on people and computer intelligence. So if I'm looking for a replacement for this cable, for example, and I don't know what it is, but I can take a picture with my phone. So my query is, where do I buy a cable like this, right? And a search engine will not be able to answer this, at least today. So the idea was then to use the crowd. So you go with this human question and ask people for advice, not necessarily which is the cable, but maybe they can tell me, oh, go to Amazon and submit the query for VGA cable. So there's a phase where I can get more information, queries that I can submit at some site, and then I can go and look for cables, and then I can ask the crowd to match and say, okay, do you think this is a good cable for this particular query? So it's again not a search engine for everybody, but it's a search engine for the busy person like myself, that I don't want to spend too much time browsing and so on, and I can wait a day before somebody comes back with a solution of which is a good cable for me.
I think another great example is Stack Overflow, where you actually, let's say you have some coding question, right? And it's actually quite reliable.
Yes.
It's probably the best source you put a question that people actually answer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are all these sites, and there's some sites where they're for math equations. One of my students was having problems with solving some equation, some regression. So he went to this math site. I don't even remember the name because I didn't do it. And you had some really competent mathematicians helping you out and giving you a solution. It would work great. So that's another example. OK, I think we're out of time.
Great. Thank you
so
very much.
Thank you for listening to me. I appreciate it. Thanks for the question.